Welcome to the celebration of the Eucharist on the 22nd Sunday of Ordinary Time. In the second reading, St. James encourages us to be doers of the word and not hearers only. Let us pray for the strength to live the gospel message as we sing the gathering song, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus, number 732. 732.
Let us begin our celebration in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My dear brothers and sisters, as we gather here today to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us first acknowledge our sins and our weaknesses, then ask the Lord once more for his pardon, mercy, and peace. Lord Jesus, you raise the dead to new life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you bring pardon and peace to the sinner. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you bring light to those in darkness. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the
Let us pray. God of might, giver of every good gift, put into our hearts the love of your name, so that by deepening our sense of reverence, you may nurture in us what is good, and by your watchful eye, keep safe what you have nurtured. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Now, Israel, hear the statutes and decrees which I am teaching you to observe, that you may live and may enter in and take possession of the land which the Lord, the God of your fathers, has given you. In your observance of the commandments of the Lord your God, which I enjoin upon you, you shall not add to what I command, you shall not subtract from it. Observe them carefully, for thus will you give evidence of your wisdom and intelligence to the nations, who will hear of all these statutes and say, 'This great nation is truly a wise and intelligent people. For what great nation is there that has God so close to it as the Lord our God is to us whenever we shall call upon him? Or what great nation has statutes and decrees that are as just as this whole law for which I am setting before you today?' This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. James. Dearest brothers and sisters, all good giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no alteration or shadow caused by change. He willed to give us birth by the fruit, the words of truth, that he may be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Humbly welcome the word that has been planted in you and is able to save your souls. Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deluding yourselves. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained by the world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Pharisees with some scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they observed that some of his disciples ate their meals with unclean, that is, unwashed hands. For the Pharisees, and in fact all Jews, do not eat without carefully washing their hands, keeping the tradition of the elders. And on coming from the marketplace, they do not eat without purifying themselves. There are many other things that they have traditionally observed, the purification of cups and jugs and kettles and beds. So the Pharisees and scribes questioned him, "Why do your disciples not follow the tradition of the elders, but instead eat a meal with unclean hands?" He responded, "Well did Isaiah prophesy about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines human precepts. You disregard God's commandments, but cling to human tradition.'" He summoned the crowd again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. Nothing that enters one from outside can defile that person, but the things that come out from within are what defile. From within, people, from their hearts, come evil thoughts, unchastity, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, licentiousness, envy, blasphemy, arrogance, folly. All these evils come from within, and they defile." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
William Buckley, the famous Scottish theologian, tells the story about an elderly rabbi who was imprisoned because of his faith. Now, while he was in prison, however, he was given enough food and water to sustain him. Wasn't a whole lot, but enough to survive. But despite this, the prison officials noticed that he was becoming weaker and weaker and weaker. And so it caused them some concern. So they ordered that a doctor be brought in to evaluate him. The doctor did the evaluation and came to the conclusion that the elderly rabbi was dehydrated. Now, they couldn't understand the prison officials why this was happening. After all, he had enough food and water to sustain himself. So the doctor told them to observe what he is doing to see if we could come up with some answers here. So the prison officials began to observe the rabbi. And what they noticed he was doing was taking the water, purifying his hands before he would say his prayers. He would purify his hands before he would eat his meals. He would sprinkle his bed with water before he would go to sleep. So as a result, there was very little water for him to consume. I like that story because I think it highlights this dispute that's taking place in our gospel today, this dispute between the religious leaders and Jesus. So what is the foundation of all this? Well, by way of background, we need to understand a little bit about the Mosaic Law. When we talk about the law, the Hebrew law, we're talking about one of two things. We're either talking about the written law or the oral law. Now, the written law was the older of the laws and the most important. It's what the Jews would refer to as the Torah. We would see it as those first five books of the Bible. It's often referred to as the law of Moses. And as I said, this was the most important law. But some of those laws are concrete and specific, but others were very general, more like norms than laws. For a long time, the Jews were simply content with these general norms. They applied it to their lives as they saw fit. However, around the 5th century before the birth of Christ, among the Jews came a group known as scribes. The scribes took it upon themselves to take these general norms, which they felt were too vague, and to spell them out in detail, to make them more concrete, if you will. This gave rise then to the second kind of law, the oral law, or oral traditions. Also, around that time, there developed among the average Jew the desire to imitate the holiness of their priest. So they began to observe what they did. What the priest would do before they would go into the sanctuary of the temple was to wash their hands. It was to symbolize ritual purity, that as they're entering into the Holy of Holies, that they should be pure, free from sin, if you will. Now the average Jew began to adopt those practices, not only to wash their hands before prayer, but before meals, and as we heard in our gospel today, they began to sprinkle their objects, beds and kettles and cups and so on. At first glance, this seemed like a good thing. What they wanted to do was to bring this religion of theirs into their everyday lives, to have an effect in their everyday lives. But very quickly, it became an abuse. What they began to realize is to take these rituals, these habits, and develop this notion that to the extent that I carry them out faithfully, that this is a sign of holiness. This is a sign of being religious. This is what's pleasing to God. What was lost in it is the motivation for all of this. Now, William Barclay speaks about this. He says, for example, a person could have hatred in their heart, greed in their heart, pride in their heart, but as long as they're faithfully carrying out all these rituals, in their estimation, they're doing what is pleasing to God, holy in his sight. Barclay goes on to give another story to underscore what an abuse this is. He tells the story about this Muslim who was on horseback in pursuit of his enemy to kill him. As the pursuit is continuing, the public call to prayer sounds. He stops his horse, gets off of it, unrolls his prayer rug, kneels down, and faithfully says all his prayers, quickly, but says them all. Rolls up his prayer rug, puts it back on the horse, and goes in pursuit of his enemy in order to kill him. So we can see that he followed through the rituals, but what was in his heart was far from God.
So the question arises, well, how does all this apply to us? Well, first of all, there are rituals we have in our church. First of all, do we even understand what those rituals are? We perform them faithfully, but do we even understand what their meaning is? For example, when we come into church, we bless ourselves with holy water. We do that faithfully. But if someone were to ask us to explain why we do that, would we be able to give an explanation? Or is it just something we do as Catholics? Do we understand that it is to remind us of baptism, that sacrament that brings us into a relationship with a loving God, brings us into community that we call a church, that we were washed clean in baptism of our sin, it calls us to holiness, that as we're coming now to offer sacrifice, that we should be pure? Do we understand that we're filled with the Holy Spirit in baptism? So gathering into worship, we are filled with the Spirit, coming here to worship our God. What a beautiful ritual it is, but the symbolism is far greater if we understand it. Do we understand why we genuflect when we get into the pew? Sometimes that seems to be lost anymore. Some people don't even genuflect at all, we just simply get into the pew. We're losing a very good tradition, because by genuflecting, we're acknowledging an important aspect of our faith, that Jesus Christ is present here in that tabernacle, that we're coming in the presence of God. He invites us into his house to be with him. What an awesome honor that is. And what is due him is some sign of respect. So if we're able to, we are to genuflect, to show that respect. If we're unable to genuflect, because of age or issues, we should do a bow with our eyes at that tabernacle, not at the altar or at the cross or anywhere else. Again, it's a beautiful ritual, but it's underscoring a beautiful fact about our faith, a belief about our faith, that Jesus is truly present in that blessed sacrament. Before the gospel, if you notice, we make the sign of the cross on our forehead, our lips, and over our heart. It's a beautiful sign, but what's the meaning of it if someone were to ask you? Well, it's now to prepare ourselves, to open ourselves most fully to the proclaimed word of the gospel, that gospel word is going to be in my mind, on my lips, and in my heart, that word now is going to transform me in some way, to change me, that I'm open to this encounter of Jesus in that proclaimed word. What a beautiful tradition it is. Many of you have the tradition of coming here each weekend. You get in your car at your house, you drive all the way over here to be in St. Benedict Church. You come here faithfully, and that's a good habit. But there's even something more important than that habit, even something better, that coming here now, blessing ourselves, genuflecting to the Eucharist, we are preparing ourselves for this beautiful encounter with God, to enter into worship. That's the whole purpose of coming here, not just to be here, but to worship God Almighty, a loving God who is here to be with you, to help sustain you through all your difficulties and your challenges and so on. And recognizing his goodness, his blessings, how marvelous it is, we want nothing more than to raise our voices in praise of God, participating in the prayers, singing the songs, entering into the worship, united with this community of faith. What a beautiful thing it is. We simply allow ourselves to do that. Yes, it's important to come here, and that is a good thing, but that's not the end of our worship by being just present. It's only the beginning of this beautiful experience. So what is our Lord challenging us to do today? Well, first of all, he's asking us to look at what we do, but to come to a realization of what we do is not so much what counts. What counts is the love in our hearts that motivates us to do what we do. If our hearts are filled with bitterness and anger and pride and selfishness, then no external practices or rituals in the world will make us holy or pleasing before God. Today's gospel invites us to look into our hearts and to ask ourselves, At what extent do the words in today's second reading apply to us? Notice what was said. Do not deceive yourselves by just listening to God's word. Pure and genuine religion is this: to take care of the orphans and the widows, and to keep oneself from being corrupted by the world. Or to what extent do we embrace those words of Isaiah, which Jesus cites in today's gospel, when he says, "These people honor me with their words, but their heart is really far from me." Hopefully that doesn't apply to us. When short, what counts is not so much what we do, but why we do it. What counts is the love in our hearts, that love of God and that love of our neighbor. So as we gather here today, let us listen to the word of God. Allow it to penetrate our hearts. Come to the table of the Eucharist. Allow the grace of Holy Communion to shape us into those disciples, those noble disciples, and allowing this discipleship that the Lord calls us to make a real difference in our lives, and hopefully to make a difference in the world, in the lives of the people around us. God bless you all.
Our profession of faith: I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Striving to live by the wisdom of God and not by our own wisdom, we pray for the church and the world.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, Bishop Mark, and all the bishops, clergy, and consecrated men and women, may they be empowered by the Holy Spirit as they guide and serve the church, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our president and all world leaders, may they be filled with zeal to serve the poor, uphold the oppressed, and strive for peace through justice, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish family, may they desire to find the lost and care for the poor, move the hearts of young men and women towards vocations within the church, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Christians throughout the world who are persecuted for their belief in Jesus Christ, and for all those who suffer for the sake of others, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For refugees and those fleeing war and famine, for those made homeless by flood, fire, and storm, and for all who cry to the Lord for mercy, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, the elderly, the homebound, and the hospitalized, Jean and Dick Losenhoff, Mary Bicko, Jeff Podesnik, Charlie, Nikki, Brenda, Klaus, Cherry, Terry, For those named in our bulletin and for all in need of the Lord's peace and healing, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Gloria Tompkins, Gail Roth, Dick Ruth, Father Anthony Petruca, and all the faithfully departed for whom we offer this Eucharist, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have asked for our prayers, for our personal intentions, for those written on our parish book and website, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, you give us your flesh and blood for the life of the world, and you desire that all people come to the supper of the sacrifice of the Lamb. Renew in your church the truth, beauty, and goodness contained in the most blessed Eucharist.
Father of all blessings, fill us with your Holy Spirit, so that we might humbly and faithfully work for the glory of your name and your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please join in singing the song for the preparation of the gifts, Only This I Want, number 505.
My dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name,
for our good and the good of all his holy church. May this sacred offering, O Lord, confer on us always the blessing of salvation, that when it celebrates in mystery, it may accomplish in power. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God. You laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder to rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Oh,
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat his bread and drink his cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come on.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Mark, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. On earth as it is in heaven, give trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other now a sign of Christ's peace.
The Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
In order to join us spiritually to the Eucharist, my Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment, receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Let us pray. Renewed by this bread from the heavenly table, we beseech you, Lord, that being the food of charity, it may conform our hearts and stir us to serve you in our neighbor, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. Please join in singing the closing song, City of God, number 391. 391.